Philip Joseph Pierre.
I would like to be judged as being the Prime Minister, not being judged as being part of a government.
Came into government that we had a manifesto and a vision and mission that had been approved by my party, by the highest body.
Parcel 11 has not been in existence. 50 was
spraying. Giant getting bazooka. Spraying big on to knock out mosquitoes.
I have never had a joint account with anybody in my life. Not my ex-wife, not my children, nobody. And I will refer that to the privileges committee.
What about the culture of people getting into office and not being effective in taking
what people become prime ministers and leadership? I've been the most ready.
Let's do it this Wednesday, because if it's Wednesday, it's Newsmaker Live.
A very good evening to you. Welcome to another edition of Newsmaker Live right here on DBS Television. With me, Timothy Polion. We go up until 10 o'clock, at which time we conclude with the clip that peaked. In case you have forgotten about her, you have forgotten her name, we just want to give you a reminder, and who better to do that than her mom. I'm referring there to deceased Kimberly DeLeon, who was shot and killed on the evening of October 29th of 2018. The incident occurring at her home on the Mon. Since then, we've heard of police investigating. We've heard of reports being forwarded to the DPP. And there's been some demonstration, people bearing placards, but nothing of note has really come out of this homicide, which certainly would have shocked many people in the St. Lucian society. And the mother of Kimberly DeLeon is my guest. She is Mary Williams. On the 29th of October of this year, we'll mark the 6th anniversary of her murder. Good evening to you, Ms. Williams. Welcome to the broadcast.
Good evening, Tim, and thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Of course, later we'll be speaking about Kimberly DeLeon at length. But considering the environment we're existing right now with so many homicides, we had about 24 homicides so far for this year. What do you think about the spate of killings in St. Lucia over the last few years, and in particular this year? I mean, we're just into April and we already have 24 homicides.
Too many. Who do we hold responsible for that? What is the Prime Minister, the Minister of Homeland Security, what is the police, what are all these people doing about that? You know, we need to have a force that will help curb that crime in St. Lucia. Too many. You go to bed, by the time you wake up next day, 2 days later, one here, one there. That's too many. Too many. St. Lucia cannot afford that. It's too much of a small country, and we need to keep our reputation. We don't need all these killings.
But when you say the police, when you say the Prime Minister, Minister for National Security, those people holding the key position as far as law enforcement is concerned in setting policy and various guidelines, people have a tendency to say that crime is our business and we all have a part to play. What do you think about this when people say that?
I would say yes. You know, like the police say, see something, say something. But you see something, you say something, you put your life and your family life at risk. Are they going to keep it a secret? Are they going to cover your back in case of anything? You understand? The Prime Minister on his own cannot solve the crime. The people on the ground are the ones who solve the crime. But there is no protection. There is no protection for them. They aid the police with information, and then they have to be walking the street like they're schizophrenic because they don't know who's watching them or who's coming after them.
So therefore, what you're saying is it's something that is absolutely difficult. Something that is more complicated, because if you're saying on one hand you agree that it's our business to help the police to fight crime, on the other hand people are very skeptical in doing so because they're fearful for their lives.
Yeah.
But it stands to reason that what? We cannot expect to make any kind of major progress anytime soon. Those things are not going to change in a hurry?
Not anytime soon. Mm-hmm. Not anytime soon. We may have to bring in some outside forces to assist. We may have to look into replacing the DPP. You understand? Because in my opinion, it's a paycheck and nothing doing. And, you know, we have to do something about that crime in St. Lucia. But it's difficult. It's difficult.
But sometimes when people like yourself, although you have a front seat row, you're in the front seat row and you have gone through the experience. When you speak on such issues, do you feel that you're taken seriously, although you're the relative of a victim of a murder?
I don't know if I'm taken seriously because I'm not in the minds of the persons who are supposed to be, you know, solving the crime or help mm-hmm. solve the crime. But I think, you know, it's like they are saying, well, oh, that's just another one. You know, there is nothing, we'll just frustrate her until she forgets about it. I'm not going to get frustrated. I will only stop fighting when I'm dead.
You believe that people are trying to frustrate you into forgetting about the murder of your daughter?
Look, the police is trying to frustrate me, and I'm not going to put water in my mouth to say it. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. They come at me with all kinds of cheap shots. You understand? I'm not a fool. You see, I am not a fool. And when they come, I ask questions. Then sometimes they don't have answers to the questions that I'm asking. Maybe they think I'm too smart to be asking these questions. I don't know. But if that's my gift, that's my gift. I'm going to ask questions. It's my daughter who lost her life.
But are they volunteering information to you? Are they updating you on the state of the investigation?
I've never gotten a call from the police saying, okay, look, I'm calling you to give you an update on the case. I have to be walking and walking. And even then, they're still throwing lies in my face, cheap shots in my face. You know, always have something to send out here, always have something to get there. And when I go back to get an update, then they give me another lie again. So it's just a continuous thing. One lie after another after another.
But how do you know that they are lying?
Based on the issue, the question, the answer, then I can know it's a cheap shot.
But why do you think that the police, although that's not a complaint that is unique to your particular case, people have a tendency to say that the police, there's no follow-up from the police in terms of periodic updates to the relatives of murder victims. But why do you think that this is the case? Why do you think that police are not providing you with timely updates?
They are not. I guess they want to sweep it under the rug. It's one of their own who is a suspect. I wasn't there. Mm-hmm. As they said, they identified a person and named that person a person of interest. So I did not serve him the godmother at that point. You understand? So that's what it is. You are doing nothing. Every time I come, one story after another, then the stories do not add up. You know? So they are just trying to sweep it under the rug, trying to get me frustrated that I will say, well, okay, you know, it is what it is. She's already dead. God will take care of anything. God has too many things on his account to take care of.
So you're not one of the solutions that would say, I leave it in the hands of God.
I leave it in the hands of God. God has enough on his account, because if I do not get up and make a step and ask him to guide me, you understand, guide me and give me strength and give me courage, nothing's going to happen. I cannot leave everything to him. He has his role, but I have to play my role as well.
What keeps you going as far as your determination to find justice for your daughter?
Well, my granddaughter keeps me going. Mm-hmm. She keeps me going because sometimes I'm like, you know, when she says certain things or does certain things, then I would see, well, okay, you know, I have to be there for her because that's what her mother would have wanted. So I have to play the role. You understand? And I'm doing the best that I can.
Why do you think that the justice system continues to fail people like you?
Because nothing is being done. How many cases are being solved? How many, you know, families go to the law, go to the DPP, go to the police, and they come out with a smiling face, you know, or they come out knowing, well, at least something is being done, or something new has happened, or they have gotten some new information. We don't get that. Families of victims do not get that. Yes, and so therefore, we are of the opinion that they don't care, right? Because, especially in my case, they had to assign an officer to me to update me. But until I go to them and make trips, many trips, then I do not get to see anybody. And if I do get to see somebody, they try to give me the you know, the I don't hear that. That's not an answer, you know, and all this. No. Up until now, the lead investigator, I'm not afraid to say it. He can be listening. I don't care. The lead investigator, the last time I spoke with him, he said there was one thing that they needed. I said, okay. I went back 2-3 weeks later to get an update. I asked him, well, what happened to that one thing you said you wanted to get? Oh, the place closed down. I asked him, well, is there somewhere else you can send to look for whatever it is you're looking for? No, that's a blatant lie. That's a lie. So you mean to tell me there is only one place in the whole wide world that could have given you what is it you are looking for? Cheap shot. And I must accept that? No.
But why would you believe that at this particular juncture, close to 6 years after the murder of your daughter, that the police will deliberately straddle you on and not want to investigate this particular matter successfully? Don't you think that has something to do with, for example, the backlog of cases? There's so many homicides that are occurring that they have to grapple with, and they only a limited number of police officers who could deal with all those cases.
Tim, I once spoke to the DPP, and he said to me they had everything in order. They were only waiting for the ballistic report. And that is why, I don't know if you recall, I came out with that translators needed. Mm-hmm. Because after so long not hearing anything, then I had to say, well, okay, I will look for help for y'all. Because if for so long you cannot get the letter translated, then I must look for help for you.
As a matter of fact, we have this report that we'll play right now. The report was aired 3 years ago during the DBS News World, and then I'll have you to speak a little bit on this. The letter that you, at the time you were in Constitution Park, and you were volunteering to get the resources to have this particular letter translated. Apparently, it took the form of a letter, but a report from Martinique to the authorities in St. Lucia regarding the probe into your daughter's murder.
Mary Williams, the mother of 42-year-old Kimberly De Leon, who was shot and killed at her Mon apartment on October 29th, 2018, showed up outside Parliament Tuesday morning, displaying a letter that she says needs to be translated. The original letter, according to Williams, which contains a report from Martinique regarding the weapon which was used to take her daughter's life, is in the hands of the police.
I am out here hoping that somebody will assist me in translating the letter, because I need to get to the bottom of my daughter's death.
The mother of the deceased is also in a custody battle for her grandchildren, and she is very confident that she will triumph.
Very confident.
Mary Williams is determined to continue putting all her energy into finding justice for her daughter. The police could not provide an update on the matter. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
And that report was filed some 3 years ago by Don Nicholas. Obviously, that's not you didn't have the actual letter in your hand. But what happened as far as translating that letter from the French authorities for the benefit of our local law enforcement personnel in St. Lucia, as far as you know?
Up until now, nobody can give me any answer. Nobody calls me, nobody tells me nothing. I am the one having to go, which of course I don't have a problem. Mm-hmm. I will go and I will speak to who I have to speak. I was also told that the officer, the lead investigator, he said that he has to go, he has to send some document to the Attorney General. I said to him, why send to the Attorney General as opposed to you bringing it to the Attorney General? And he said, yeah, well, that's what, you know, I will bring it. And up until now, I spoke with the Attorney General.
This was when?
Earlier this year.
Okay.
I spoke to the Attorney General on the matter. We had a conversation about it. And he said his office has nothing to do with that. But yet the police keep saying that he is part of it. His office is part of it. So now, who do I believe? Do I believe the police? Do I believe the Attorney General? I don't know. I don't know.
But how did you get wind of that letter, which needed translation?
Well, when I visited the DPP one time, he said that they had received the result of the ballistic report, and all they needed to do was translate it.
Okay.
You understand? So I was still waiting to hear. He'll tell me, well, okay, yes, it has been done, and this is where we're at. But
and this was how long ago?
That must be about 2 years ago.
2 years ago.
Or maybe a little more than 2 years ago. Well, more than 2 years ago. A little more than 2 years. But up until now, nobody is saying anything. But they keep on saying they are sending this to test, that to test, the other to test. But the DPP said that all the things they sent out for testing, that they had already gotten the results. What's the holdup? Is it a matter of you scratch my back and I scratch yours? Is it a matter of, you know, I'm covering up something for you, you covering up something for me? What's going on? I need to know what's going on, and I will continue going to the media. I'll continue to demonstrate until I cannot do it anymore.
But is going to the media, appearing on Newsmaker Live, demonstrating, do you believe that is sufficient? Because you have done it on so many occasions for a little over 5 years now. What gives you the impression that if you continue to use the same tactics, that you'll be getting a positive result?
I will be doing some additional things.
Okay.
I will be having some addition to what I've already done. But by coming out, I'm still refreshing the public that, hey, there is a case to be solved. There is a murder, a young mother at her home being gunned down for no apparent reason. You understand? And yet nothing coming. Nobody's saying anything. Nobody's doing anything. So I have to keep it alive.
And she sustained the postmortem determined that she sustained a single bullet to the head, which resulted in her succumbing to her injuries. But you said a few years ago as well, and you asked the question, will you ever get justice for Kimberly? That is a question that a number of relatives of murder victims, they are asking that same question. I don't know if we have that clip already, where you basically, in a report by the late Alex Buske, right here on DBS television, you did also ask the question rhetorically, will you ever get justice?
I've been in communication with the DPP. We've had conversations, and all I have to do is sit and wait a little longer, but patience has already run out. I ask myself a lot of questions. I have been in communication with the DPP. We've had conversations, and all I have to do is sit and wait a little longer, but patience has already run out. I ask myself a lot of questions. Will I ever get justice?
You ask yourself that question. I think that report was again some 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Will you get justice? And there are so many people before you I think the Shaka Khan incident would have occurred before you, before yes. the murder of Kimberly De Leon. And the family members are still waiting for justice.
They're still waiting for justice.
Sense the frustration in the voice of his mother when she calls the various talk shows from time to time. But can you answer your own question? Will you ever get justice?
I will pursue justice. I'll do all what I have to do. I'll go all where I have to go, and I'll speak to all who I have to speak. Until the whole world shuts its doors in my face, then I can say there is no justice. But I'm still hoping that I will get a phone call that would say, aha, aha, we have arrested someone, and that person is being charged in the connection with Kimberly De Leon's murder.
Why are you so hopeful amidst all the gloom and the disappointment that you have experienced over
Nothing
the last
is
5 years?
Nothing is impossible. Mm-hmm. Nothing is impossible. You know, you go to bed one way, you wake up next day a different way. You never know what can happen. But what I'm saying is, feet are being dragged. If you have all what you need, and you need to cross your T's and dot your I's for fear that whoever you charge in connection with the murder does not turn wrong and sue the state because of a loophole, people have, you know, I will be concerned. Yes, of course you have to dot your T's, dot your I's and cross your T's. How long are you? Are you just learning to cross a T and to dot an I? At 5 years into that case, then something is wrong. You know, something is definitely wrong. You know, we need justice. The families, you know, of these victims need justice. We have a lot of killings in St. Lucia. What are they revenge killings? You understand? What are these people saying? Well, we never know. You know, because when they look at other cases and they see nothing have been done, one, they are left to just take matters into their own hands. And you can't blame them for that, because they are frustrated, some of them, and they feel that, you know what, that's the only way I can feel good. That's the only way I can get justice. You know, we all handle things differently.
But there's a right way and a wrong way.
There's a right way and a wrong way.
And we need to do things
the right way.
The right way. But again, you're saying that you kind of sympathize with people if perchance they decide to take matters into their own hands, and again, we are totally against that. But what kind of message do you want to send to the authorities, the police, the National Security Minister? Now we have a Crime Prevention Minister, the Home Affairs Minister, Minister for Justice, etc., to ensure that people do not find themselves in a position where they see it as the alternative, taking matters into their own hands out of frustration.
I'm not sure if within the police force there's an intervention unit, because I think that can play a role in some cases. Because some cases, before it escalates, there should be a unit that will, you know, get together with both parties, sit down and talk to them and let them know, you know, certain things were not necessary and you could have done it differently, you know. I think helping to solve crime can start from there, but I'm not too sure whether or not there is an intervention unit within the police force.
But how long do you anticipate that this will go on in terms of you not getting a positive response? Because it's when I'm asking the question, what I find very strange is that the police is not proactive in such a case that was so well publicized. Now, proactive in the sense of not solving the case, because I'm not in a position to say that the police have all the evidence before them and they're in a position, or the DBP is in a position to try the case. But definitely in terms of ensuring that you are updated reasonably, within a reasonable period, because every time you appear on this broadcast, you keep saying that you're not receiving any kind of updates from the police. This I find to be very strange.
They're not giving me any updates. Every time I go to them, they're singing the same song. The same song. You know, we have to send this over there, we send that over there, we are waiting for it. It's the same thing over and over and over again. Do I want to spend the rest of my life hearing that? No. No, because I was told at one point that they had everything. Mm-hmm. And all they were missing was the transition of the letter. You got the letter up until now. Nobody's saying anything. All they promised, well, you know, I'll let you know what's happening unless I do not get up and go to them, make trips. Sometimes I don't see the officer. I make how many trips and I don't see him. Or somebody would call him and say, well, I'm here, whatever. But the person would come back and say to me, he said he would give you a call. Never happened.
How does that make you feel?
How it does make me feel? You don't want to see the state of my mind at that point. You don't want. That's where God comes in. Mm-hmm. That's where God comes in. Because I'm not fighting that alone. You know, as I say, I will get up, I will go to who I have to go to. I will speak with all the authorities, all those whom I have to speak with. But he is giving me the courage and the strength to fight on.
When was the last time you spoke with any law enforcement personnel on the matter?
Last year.
Last year, okay.
Yeah. But earlier this year, when the officer approached me, he said that I asked him if he brought me some good news, and he said, I came to you for two things. One, I spoke with the psychologist, and she said she would agree to meet with your daughter, because at one point he said to me that he wants to speak to he wants a forensic psychologist to speak with my granddaughter. I said, I have no problem with that. However, I am not going to allow you and your psychologist in a room with her. I am going to have a private person, somebody who she's comfortable with, present as well. But it didn't sit well with him, but I insisted that they are not going to speak with her. I don't want to be in the room for fear of intimidation. Mm-hmm. So I will have somebody there. That when I spoke to her psychologist, she said that she does not really do these things. But then the officer came to me and said she called and that she said she would give a date. That's how many months now? That's how many months? Then he will come to me and ask me about some other matter that did not pertain to me. You understand? No, tell me about my what pertains to me, what I'm dealing with, what you know, my daughter's murder. She was not sick. She was not in an accident. She was at her home and she got killed. So is it okay for that to happen? No. Whether it's my daughter or anybody else. You understand? So they don't give me updates until I go to them and they keep throwing cheap shots at me, but not. I'm not going to swallow it.
What do you think will make a difference in terms of persons like yourself? And because increasingly, we have so many homicides occurring. You have so many males being murdered, whether you have gang violence and so on. I could just imagine that there are a number of mothers around the Senusha who are grieving as we speak right now. So what is the solution for grieving mothers in terms of getting justice on behalf of whether it's their sons or their daughters?
You have to pursue justice. You don't just sit down and justice come to you. You have to get up and go and look for the justice. Put pressure, apply pressure to the justice system. And one person alone cannot do it. You have to have a team. You know, collectively, it will be stronger. But when it's just one, it's no strength. It's weak. But then everybody, well, most people think they can solve it on their own. I can solve it on my own. But if I have a team with me fighting the same cause, somebody ought to hear us. Somebody has to hear us.
So far, what level of assistance have you received from members of the public or any professional organization in your quest and in your search for justice?
Nothing. Absolutely nothing. I'm fighting this all alone. And it's okay. It's my daughter. So I'm going to fight.
But don't you think that you'll be more effective, more prudent, if, for example, all the mothers, grieving mothers, relatives come together and mount some kind of challenge?
Well, that's what I say. You see, if you form a team, if you know, we do it collectively. But when you want to do it single-handedly, it's not going to send the message that you're really looking for. But collectively, yes.
But why do you think the reluctance for all the sides, the grieving sides or parties, to come together?
I don't know.
Made any overtures, any offers?
No, I haven't. Yes, it has crossed my mind, but yeah. I have not made that move.
The St. Lucian Society, do you believe that they have forgotten about Kimberly DeLeon? Because, I mean, as the song says by T.C. Ron, where are they now? So the sooner time elapses and people are not hearing about you in the news anymore, you're no longer somebody that they can make reference to, or you're no longer relevant, people move on. In the case of Kimberly DeLeon, in terms of what you think happening to the society, you think that people have forgotten her?
I would say yes and no, because there are some people who still ask about the case, ask about, you know, her kids, ask about how am I coping with that, and how, you know, because we all would like to, you know, to see something happen. We want closure, you understand? But I think, as I say, collectively, if we form time from time to time, we go out there, we match. We have our placards, we match, you know, everybody, you know, her friends, whatever, would come out, hold a placard, be there, do something, you know, it would say much more. Because, you know, I'm not in their minds to say every Tom, Dick, and Harry, you know, has they have forgotten about her, but I don't know. That's the life of it in, you know, in St. Lucia. When things are hot, it's hot, and when, you know, it's cold, it's not that they may have forgotten, but when it's cold, it's cold. And when it's hot, it's hot.
What was your feeling like when, for example, there was this gathering which took place at Constitution Park a few years ago to coincide with the anniversary of her murder? Had you ever had a gathering somewhere seeking justice?
Oh, yes. I remember one time, yes, yeah. Me and some of my family members. Mm-hmm. Yes.
What was your feeling like at the time, at the moment? Were you then hopeful based on the fact that it was fresh in your mind and people were out there, some people were supporting?
Yeah, I would say that. I would say that. But, you know, as time elapses, then, you know, you see a different side of things. You see, but that's my daughter. And sometimes I forget about, you know, a friend here or a person there, you know, who is concerned. My thing is, I am her mother, and I am going to do what I have to do. I'll pursue justice. I will go to the end of the world if I have to go to look for justice for my daughter.
If that takes you where? Beyond the shores of St. Lucia?
Beyond the shores. If I have to go beyond the shores of St. Lucia, crawl, walk, fly, whatever the case may be, I will do it.
But why don't you think it would not take something happening in St. Lucia for you to get justice?
Well, if it had to happen, it happened already. After 5 years, after saying you had all what you needed, what more do you need? What more do you need?
If you get an audience with the police commissioner, the first female police commissioner, what would you like to tell her?
Oh, I've met you.
You've met you for?
I've met you for about twice.
How did you organize that meeting?
Oh, I went to the office and okay. I said that I needed to speak with her.
Mm-hmm. You know, when was that?
Last year. I spoke with her last year. Mm-hmm. And then I went again. But the last time I went, that was sometime this year, I went to her and she was not in. But when she came in, she had an urgent meeting, and so she allowed me to speak to another officer who was just trying to play cat and mouse with me with that case. Okay. And, you know, tried to hurry me out of the office. You understand? And it wasn't good enough. But that same officer was also there when a former commissioner of police was there. So he's all too familiar with everything, you know? But, and he said to me that he would call the investigating officer and tell him to update me. I have not heard from anybody. That's how they treat me.
Good. Well, how was your meeting with the police commissioner?
Well, we spoke and she did make a phone call, and I don't know what was said because I was not privy to hearing. And she said that, you know, they told her that she was still, they were still like gathering probably more information, and you know. But you cannot blame her. It's whatever they told her. Because she, you know, she's not the one investigating. Okay, so if they told her they are missing something, that's what she has to say. All she can do is question them about what's missing and why it's taking long, or if it's not taking long. But it's whatever they tell her, she repeats.
God forbid you were to close your eyes anytime soon and this matter is left unresolved. What do you think that would say about the Zenushan society and the justice system?
A rotten justice system as usual, and it would be the same thing. There is no justice in St. Lucia. But God forbid, I ain't going nowhere. I will live long enough to see that case solved. I'll live long enough.
That's the extent to which you're determined
to
find justice?
To find justice.
Do you ever feel helpless? Do you ever feel like giving up?
No, I wouldn't give up.
Why?
Give up? No. Mm-hmm. You see, I keep moving. Yeah, I'll move. When they think, they say, well, she's dumb and she's not doing anything now. I'm coming right back at them again. You see, because I have to be strong. You know, I have to be strong. I have to keep going. I cannot sit down and say, well, okay, let me wait. Someday they'll come with something. Someday. And then I end up nowhere. So I want questions answered. I'm going to move. I'm going to speak to people. I'm going to do what I have to do. I will keep moving.
The elected officials in St. Lucia, and I'm talking about generally all elected officials, they normally set the agenda and they normally focus on things that they believe that are of importance to the electorate, to the voters. And therefore, they use that interest to galvanize support and to win seats and to win general elections. Why do you believe that the justice system does not form the centerpiece of their campaigns in the run-up to a general election, whether it's this party or that party, in any party in St. Lucia? Why do you think that is the case?
During election, everybody wants to win, okay? I don't care, red, yellow, green, black, or white. Everybody wants to win. There are certain things they will leave out of the campaign, and certain things they will, you know, use as centerpieces. They will touch base on certain things and they will forget about other things. That's the nature of the game. See, that's the nature of the game. You know, it's just a matter of they wanting to do things. They see things supposed to be done. So they come, they preach about it. They use it, you know. But the thing is, when they get in office, and I'm not talking about this one, this government or the last government, whichever government is in power, when you get into office, are you going to follow up on all the things that you promise? Can you follow up on all the things that you promise? Do you have the tools to follow up on everything that you promise?
Do you think also they're taking their cue from persons like yourself and even other grieving relatives who are not making those issues a priority in terms of informing the prospective candidates, prospective MPs, those who are waiting to get into office, those who are in government, in letting them know that that is the agenda that we are setting as far as whatever issues that are affecting us, as far as the priority?
I don't hear, I have not heard any one of them come out, you know, in this regard. All they will tell you is crime, and we are fighting crime. But then there are some things you have to give priority.
But isn't the onus on people like yourself and other relatives who are grieving, who lost a family member in such tragic circumstances, to want to set the agenda? How do you think persons like yourself can set the agenda?
By applying pressure. By applying pressure, by holding forums, by demonstrating, by writing letters, by, you know, seeking an audience with, I would say, Homeland Security Minister, Minister in Charge of Crime, whichever way they want to put it, you know. But will they want to hear us? That's the next thing. Even if we decide we are going to get together to do that, will they want to hear us? Because the thing is, whenever you go to these offices, first thing they tell you, what is it you want to see him for? I'll take your name or number, and then they never call you. I'm tired of that because I'm not giving any name or number. You see, I am not, and I tell them that all the time. I'm tired of coming, and then you tell me you'll give me your information and I will call you, and I hear nobody calling you, so I'm showing up. That's what I'll do. I'll show up. So, but we must have, it will have to take more than one person. You understand? More than one person to go and say, look, this is what's happening. We are against it. We need answers. It's been so long. We have to apply pressure to the powers that be in order to get them to understand that, hey, something is not working. And that which is not working has to be fixed. You see? We have a poor justice system in St. Lucia. Sometimes I look at the Royal St. Lucia Police Force as another security company. You know, another security company and not a St. Lucia Police Force. Because what? What are they doing? I'm not hearing much. You see, I am not hearing much.
Do you ever reminisce? Do you ever sit and think of what would life be right now in 2024, if your daughter were alive? Should have been what, at least 50, 51, thereabout?
Yeah, somewhere thereabout. Mm-hmm. Well, should it be enjoying her children as usual? Enjoying her life as usual?
And how does that make you feel as a mom? Because, you know, we continue to hear this, the phrase that, you know, a mother or father should not be bearing their children.
Yeah, I mean, you know, enrage is an understatement. I sometimes it just throw me off, like, you know, I want to think of so many things, and but I tell myself, no, mm-hmm. no, you're gonna fight it, and you're gonna fight it the right way. You know, you're gonna fight it the right way. I'm not going to be a copycat like other. No. There is a law. There's the law, and that's the way I'm going to fight it, with the law.
For as far as you're aware now, who is holding back this particular case? Because I think at some point I heard that the report was forwarded to the DPP. So based on your interaction with law enforcement and based on what they're telling you, is that what they are still waiting for the outcome of some kind of test?
Well, that's what the officer said, but then he has already answered that, because he said that wherever he had sent it to, the place is closed, and that there was nowhere else that could have done what he wanted. So I don't know what's going on. Nobody's speaking to me, nobody's updating me, nothing.
Have you sought an audience, for example, with the Prime Minister on this?
No, I went to the Prime Minister's office one day and to make an appointment to speak with him. And there again, he's not in, but if you give me your number, your information, I will contact you and give you a date. I said, no, I'm tired of leaving numbers and information and nobody's calling. I am not giving you. I'm not. Because that's just space you're taking up in a book for no reason. They don't call you.
So you don't feel being taken seriously as far as resolving that particular case?
No. You know, I have not spoken to the Prime Minister, so I cannot, you know, I don't know how he feels or what he thinks about it. Because whenever I go, he's always, you know, out. I mean, if he has matters to take care of, he has to be out to take care of his business, you know, it's okay. But I am hoping to see him, I would say, before month end. I give myself month end.
What do you say to the Saint Lucian public? The fact that you are on tenterhooks, but yet still the Saint Lucian public, many of us, I mean, admittedly, we move on about our business because the majority of us have not been directly impacted by the crimes that are occurring. We have not lost a relative in such tragic circumstances. So there's a tendency for us to be lackadaisical or just, we just don't care. What do you say to the majority of St. Lucians as far as this particular case and other people right now who are watching this broadcast and whose case has not been resolved involving the killing of a daughter or a son? What's the message?
Look, today is one person's own, tomorrow is another. You understand? So you cannot sit by and say, well, okay, it has never happened to me, so I don't care. No, you never know when, you know, if it will happen to you or not. It's only when it happens, you will know. Therefore, you have to stand up and support the grieving families. You understand? Stand up and support them. Don't just, you know, let it fly by because it's not you or not your family member. You know, you have to support them because it's crime. You never know when crime is knocking at your door. It's only after it has knocked, then you understand what this other person is going through.
And what is your experience? How has that this case impacted you as a person? Because I'm sure before that, particularly you're living overseas, you'd have heard of homicides occurring back home in St. Lucia. And maybe like the rest of us, maybe you did not take so much of a deep interest. So now you have the empirical evidence, you have the experience, you have been there. What is that experience that you have in terms of understanding, in terms of experiencing the death of someone?
Well,
and being able to sympathize with other people who go through a similar experience.
I sympathize with people when I hear, you know, a loved one has been killed, because I always ask myself, but why do they necessarily have to do that? You know, why could they have gone to the police? Why they couldn't have done it differently? You understand? And it's like, okay, so when is that going to stop? Because today I heard news of two others and I'm like, again, mm-hmm. again, when will, you know, I wouldn't say it will stop, but it can, you know, the numbers can go down.
Brilliance and level of control.
Yes. Mm. You know, because it's not going to stop.
Why do you think it's not going to stop?
It's not going to stop. That's is them, you know.
Well, I mean, it will not stop. That's a given. But don't you think that we can do certain things to manage it?
To curb it. You can curb it. But as I say, you see, there's a crime intervention unit where they can speak to both parties. If something happened, you go to the police, as I say, you call them and there's you have a round table and you know, you talk to them. Sometimes you can change the mind of one of them who had the intentions of doing something strange, something funny. You understand? You just never know. You just have to give it a try. You see, but, you know, things will always happen.
But do you think we've reached a stage where we just, crime doesn't shock us anymore?
With so many, one after the other, I think right now people like, when I hear it, it's like, just another one. It's like they're so used to it, maybe even tired of afraid to turn on the radio to hear the news or the television and for them to hear another one again. You know, so, but all I know, you know, we need to cut down. That's too high. You know, too high. Too many. Too many.
We want to hear from you right now. Let's put the telephone number on screen so that you can call and converse with my special guest, once again, Miss Mary Williams, mother of Kimberly DeLeon. Kimberly DeLeon sustained a gunshot to her head on the evening of October 29th of 2019. And it's almost 6 years now, and there's yet to be any resolution. no one has been arrested in connection with this killing, this murder. As we normally hear, police investigations are continuing into this incident. So it's a good time to hear from you. The telephone number is on screen right now, and you can call and converse with Miss Mary Williams. But as you go along, and you continue to miss your daughter, what exactly you want people to know about her this evening that probably we've not heard from you and her other relatives before?
Well, Kimberly was a caring mother. She loved her kids. She would do anything for her kids to make sure they're all right, they're fed, they're taken care of. You know, they enjoy life. She enjoyed doing things with them, you know. She was quiet, not loud like me. She was quiet. And, you know, it shocked the world when they heard that, you know. Shocked the world because they couldn't understand why Kimberly, no, why Kimberly.
And when you returned to St. Lucia upon the death of your daughter, did you arrive in St. Lucia hoping that there would have been a resolution within a reasonable time frame?
Yes.
We have a call. Good evening to you, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Good evening.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
What I find pattern strange about this case is that Kimberly was not just a daughter. She was a wife. She was a mother. And you mean, you know, you only her mother that is pursuing this? Her husband's having the wood from the husband? You know, I saw this lady pass with Kimberly's daughter sometime last week. Him and I felt bad because I knew him because really we worked together for a long time, and this is not right, you know, because maybe she hasn't got the resources to pursue justice for her daughter. This is not right. The system is letting the lady down. It is not fair. So I don't know. Let's always, I don't know, just continue in it. Pray without ceasing. Someday, one day, something will come your way. That's all I can say.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much for calling. Once again, we continue with your calls for my guest, Miss Mary Williams. Well, you heard from the caller that you should pray and something will happen. But that's not what you said earlier on. You're not the kind of person who will just pray and wait.
No, I have to pray and move and keep moving. Mm-hmm. You know, I have to pray and keep moving. Prayer is only one aspect of it.
But you're not the only person who is going through this particular experience right now, and there are so many other people right now. And maybe I could listen to the calls, Mr. Producer, because I'm not hearing the calls. So let me hear. Good evening to you, Newsmaker Live. You on the air?
Good evening, Tim. How are you doing?
Hi. Good evening to you, caller.
And good evening to Miss Mary. Goes out to Miss Mary. I want to say to her, she's strong. Do not give up, because that's what they want. They want you to give up. Your daughter deserves justice, and I want to applaud you for standing up as a mother to ensure that she gets that justice. I want to applaud Rick Wayne and you, Timothy Polio, for keeping this issue alive. My good friend Rick Wayne always brings out those issues, and there are many more cases like this, cold cases I referred to, where there's no justice. The Shaka Dan issue is one typical example. But it just shows clearly that in St. Lucia, justice can only be served for a selected few. If you do not belong to a particular bracket, a high-end politician in government, you know, you're not getting any justice. But these are the people that need justice. People like Miss Mary, the average person, because maybe the assumption is that she's not a part of the elite, she will not get justice. I want to say to Miss Mary, keep on the fight. If you have to mobilize all victims of murder, victims who families who are victims of cold cases, mobilize them and come together and agitate peacefully so that the authorities can take you all seriously do so. Because it cannot be right that justice can only be for some and not for all. Have a blessed night.
Okay, thank you so much for calling. What say you, Ms. Williams?
Well, I have plans for the coming weeks.
You have another call. Good evening to you. Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Hi, Tim.
Hi, good evening to you, Rick. Expected your call.
I was wondering why you didn't remind Mary that there, at least there are two people here who keep talking.
Can't hear you too well.
Huh?
Make a ban?
I was wondering why you didn't tell Mary that there are at least two people here who keep talking about her case.
And that includes one individual who, from time to time, can't remember her name, Kimberly DeLeon.
I always forget her name. And which is indicative of how most people must be at the time.
Yeah.
If I can't remember her name, I wonder how many St. Lucians remember her name. Mary, I think I interviewed you at least three times.
Rick is saying that he interviewed you at least three times.
Probably twice. Three times, maybe.
Two to three times, at least. Can you hear me, Tim?
Yeah, I'm in a little difficulty, but go ahead. We'll try.
Yeah. Tim, in any case, I want to address my question to you. I listened to your questions, you know, very carefully. And Mary answered you as best she could. But I couldn't help thinking that most of those questions really ought to be directed at the people who swore on the Bible to keep us safe and protect us and so on and so on.
But we all know, Rick,
imagine a police officer telling...
We know, Rick, in our St. Lucian environment, particularly now, that people who should be answering questions from the media, they do not avail themselves of such an opportunity, or they're obligated to speak to the media, and they seldom hold a press conference, seldom speak to the media on those important issues.
Well, you said they don't take the opportunity. I put it another way. They avoid such questions.
Yeah, they do.
You know, a question to Mary. Are you aware that the person who was announced the day after the homicide as a person of interest, are you aware that person has a libel case against the police?
I heard about it some time ago, but you know, that was just it. I haven't heard anything more on that.
Well, from everything I know, it's true. Now, let us say it is true. I have 99% think it's true. But let us just for a moment say it, in fact, it is true.
Hold on, Rick. Let me call my technical person that I need your assistance, please. So you could come on right while Rick is on. Go ahead, Rick.
If, in fact, the police are facing a libel suit from the person they called their prime suspect, their person of interest, and so on and so on, would you think the police are more interested in dealing with their libel case or your matter?
Well, I would guess they would be looking into the libel case before they take mine on.
And since I'm not the one interviewing, I don't want to take too much time.
Yeah, go ahead, Rick. Continue.
Thank you. The people who are calling, and it always gets back to the people. Oh, I feel for you. My heart goes out for you. And I'm reading your chat room, Tim, and everybody's sympathy. Poor lady, leave it to God, and all that kind of stuff. All of those people are affected by what happened to this lady's daughter.
Yeah.
All of them are impacted automatically when nothing is done about it. It means our justice system is dead as the lady who was shot. So when St. Lucians call you and tell you how they feel for you and what, but nobody is saying, let's get, you know, what happened? We have a woman home affairs minister, a woman. We have a woman who made fame from her son getting shot by a crazy policewoman in the States. You know who I'm talking about, Tim.
Yeah.
I'm talking about Alison Jean, who is a senator on top of everything else, a senator. You have a commissioner who is a woman. And then you have all those female leaders who are talking about domestic violence and this. And none of these people have been able to organize a pan-beating demonstration, of a nice, quiet one, do something for this, for justice in this lady's case. I mean, Mary has been standing up. She's so articulate, so very careful what she says to you, because I know a lot about the case. And I did say one time on television, and I saw somebody in your chat room remembered it, that this case has a lot of roots. That case was associated with impacts. This case has been associated by people in the know with impacts. Nobody wants to discuss impacts. No, nobody wants to go there. So, you know, you can't help but feel for Mary. And you and I can't do any more than just keep on talking. But the masses of St. Lucians who supposedly care for people like Mary, and there are others like Mary, you know. Giselle George's father, never got justice, you know. Too.
Yeah.
All of those people who died in that way, they have mothers and fathers and sisters who must live with coming into their homes or whatever and seeing a body shot up or raped and whatever, bullets everywhere. They see all that, and they see the system absolutely against them and making no effort. There is no effort being made by any administration in the last 4 years, at the very least, to improve the justice system in St. Lucia. No visible effort. Because having a police woman means absolutely nothing. It just means a nice thing for women if they want to get up in that. But what they have is a policeman, whether she's wearing a bra or whether she's wearing just regular clothes. She's a policeman, police person. And her gender has nothing to do with it. So no, we shouldn't be looking at her in terms of her gender. We should be looking at her in terms of her competence and her efficiency. We have a police force that is undermanned. And giving them a couple of cards does not begin to approach the problems we have to deal with cases like Mary. But worst of all, are we, the people of St. Lucia, who don't give a damn unless it happens to us. And then when it happens to us and nobody comes around, we say, well, St. Lucia this and St. Lucia that. But if we don't stand up for the justice that Mary's daughter deserves, that all of us deserve, then that's the way it is. I don't want to hog your show.
Okay, Rick.
I keep getting accused of that thing, but
yeah.
You know, all of the questions that you're putting to Mary there, what she's doing her best to answer, all of those questions. I mean, there needs to be an investigation into why this case has not moved, because the police
Rick, considering the norm in St. Lucia, nothing will come out of that particular investigation. It will just amount to another obstacle.
Don't break Mary's heart. Let me just tell you something that might liven her up a little bit. When a police commissioner shot a young boy at Pigeon Point.
Mm-hmm.
I was there within seconds of the thing happening. And there was a massive crowd. And Tim, almost everyone there was saying the same thing. Nothing going to happen. Well, something did happen, even though not as much as we all would have expected. But something did happen. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Something did happen. So I don't want to say, as complicated as this case is, as cold as this case has gone, and the DPP, you know, should have something to say to Mary. I don't think the Attorney General has anything to do with that, but the DPP's office, and there ought to be an investigation of the police as to why Mary's case, which they were ready to charge people with the day after, you know, Tim. The day after, mm-hmm. Now they find themselves in a court case with the person they suspected. Thank you very much for your time.
All right. Thank you so much. Let's continue to take your calls once again for my guest, Miss Mary Williams. And somebody's watching all the way in Barbados, and she says, good program. This lady is so strong. Might as well identify her, Felicia Brown. We continue with your calls on the program. Once again, this is Newsmaker Live on DBS Television. Rick is giving you some hope that something might happen, but you have been at this for a little over 5 years. Not that I'm saying you should give up, because as you said, who knows? The miracles, we have miracles from time to time, and definitely you might be able to get some kind of resolution. Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Good evening, Tim.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
Good evening, Miss Mary.
Good evening.
Good evening, Miss. Yeah, I know that what you have gone through 5-6 years about this, it takes a lot, you know, losing a daughter. As a mother, losing a daughter, it's not easy. You know, and you're actually very strong. You know, and one of the things I know for sure, you ain't getting justice in this world, but in the eyes of your Creator, there is justice. You know, that person that did that to your daughter is walking with a guilty feeling all the days of his life or her life. Whoever that actually did that to your daughter will never be innocent in the eyes of himself. He have to be suffering with that, whatever he did to your daughter. So this, you know, in the eyes of the public, you won't get what you're looking for from the government or from the court itself. But just look yourself. That justice has been served to that person, because that person could never, never in this world see, you know, a peace of mind. That person has to be living and waking up and sleeping with that kind of, you know, feeling, because that bullet going towards somebody's head and throwing on that person, you know, and seeing that person losing their life in front of the individual. That person knows themselves today, and that person knows that the justice that you're looking for, Your God has given it to you. So your children, just your grandchildren, which is your children today, just do the best that you can do. And I know you have been doing it. And your daughter is in a peace of mind in God's hand forever. Have a good night, mate.
Good night.
Thank you so much for calling. We continue your calls. We're monitoring some of the comments in the chat room. And somebody says there, Kimberly was such a sweet soul growing up with her. I can say she never stepped on an aunt or aunt. May she continue to sleep in perfect peace. And let's see if we go through some more of your comments in the chat room. Somebody says there, in a home where she was supposed to be safe. Good question, caller. And we have some more of your comments in the chat room. According to Bob Marley, I know one day the darkness must come out to light. God does not sleep. Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Hi, good night, Tim.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
Good night, Mary.
Good night.
Mary, I just want to applaud you. I really, really want to applaud you. You have never backed down from that case. And Kimberly is one of us. Kimberly is one of the CCSS crew. We miss Kimberly so much. I want you to know that.
Okay.
Thank you so much for not ever backing down.
I will never back down.
Don't ever back down, Mary. We have your back. You know who is that. So we have your back. Keep that fight up, Mary.
Yes, I will.
We miss Kimberly bad, bad, bad. Good night to you.
Okay, ma'am. Good night to you. And thank you so much for calling. We are awaiting some more of your calls. Somebody in the chat room says, I admire you, my lady. Keep it up. Do you get any kind of courage from this? Because why I'm saying that facetiously is that people in St. Lucia like to say, well, I have your back and we'll support you and so on. But what you really need is, you know, the real presence is physical support and assistance to really, you know, reap some kind of success.
Well, I appreciate all those who, you know, are still concerned, all those who want to see justice prevail. You know, I thank them for having her in their thoughts, you know, and having me in their thoughts as well. And I just want them to keep praying that someday we all will see what we are looking forward to.
Okay. But in the interim, what message do you have for the DPP? Because the DPP, unlike other DPPs in certain jurisdictions, he has not been coming forward to speak on issues of that nature, pertinent issues. Because if you have relatives coming forward, if members of the public are taking issue with how your department is handling a particular matter, one would imagine that, you know, the person who is at the helm of that particular institution would want to come out and explain and speak to the public. But in this particular case, he seems to be a little bit reluctant. So what message would you have for the DPP tonight?
If the city is too hot, back off. Resign.
That is a simple message.
Yes.
But what if he's inundated? Okay, we have a call. Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air. Hello? Hello, good evening to you, caller. Okay, I think we have lost the call. You're saying, what if, because you see, most people are holding key positions in St. Lucia, from the police commissioner to the prime minister, various government ministers, other members of parliament would tell you that they are inundated, that they're suffering from a lack of resources and things of that nature. What if you change the DPP? What if he resigns? And you have another DPP, because I've heard those complaints being lodged at almost every DPP over the last several years. Hold that point. We have a call. Good evening, Newsmaker Live. You're on the air. Hello.
Hello. Good evening.
Yes. Good evening to you, caller.
Yes.
Hello.
Good evening. Yes.
Yes. Go ahead, please, caller.
Good evening. So we have the alias. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I'm trying to hear you, but go ahead.
We have the yes, is to translate French letters.
Hello, caller?
Yes.
Anyway, continue your contribution, sir.
The question asked is what forces there for? The alias forces there to translate French documents.
Okay, you're saying?
And how the lady had to be asking first that the police would take it and go there.
Well, call it, that's the nature of life, eh? Are you still there?
I'm still there.
Yeah.
I mean, people are going, let me tell you something, man. I'm still letting him. People are taking French documents, going to the Alliance Française, and be doing the translation there. The police in a situation that the police could list order themselves and ask for the translation.
But caller, you would agree that's a sensitive document, eh? You cannot have anybody translating this for you.
Let me tell you, man. Mm-hmm. Okay, but they could have gone to one of the diplomats. This could have gone to one. If they don't know the ordinary people would be there, but the diplomats, they could have it. When I say the diplomat, the person who is here, is in point self, could have done that for the peace. That's why they're there to assist. Anyway,
okay.
Have a good night.
You too, sir. Well, I'm hoping that out of this broadcast, something positive will come out of it, and we'll be hearing from the police as soon as possible, maybe from the DPP as well, to give you an update so that this case and others you know, can be resolved. It's not only about Kimberly De Leon. You have so many other cases. You have the Shaka Dan cases. This particular case, I think, is egregious. I mean, this matter has been before the DPP. It has not been resolved. I think there's been an inquest, and yet still there has not been an outcome. So definitely there is need for us to start as soon as possible to have a justice system that is functioning for the benefit of the people of this country, so that they do not see the alternative as taking matters into their own hands. We await your calls. We have a caller 9. Good evening, Newsmaker Live. You're on the air.
Yes, good evening.
Good evening to you, caller.
All right, that's my first time calling. Let me tell you something, too. If you're Kimberly's husband, you live in the house with her, no matter what problem you had, anybody come in the house and kill her, have you ever come out and seek justice for your wife?
Well, people have different ways of dealing with issues. Ekola, we have to be extremely careful with that particular matter. People have different ways of dealing with issues. Some people might
you
be acting...
You and her husband, whatever happens between you and her, have you ever come out and say what you want justice for she and her children? And you are the children's father? Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you so much for calling, ma'am. Somebody just sent me a WhatsApp message. Somebody says there, how can the DPP be brought into a case where there is no evidence and no accused? The DPP's job starts when it is time to prosecute. That is after the investigation is completed and all the evidence is gathered. Somebody just sent me that WhatsApp message. While we continue to await your calls, once again, for my guest, Miss Mary Williams, who is the mother of Kimberly De Leon, and she was murdered on the evening of October the 29th of 2019, living to mourn her two children and also her mom and other relatives. Okay, let's see if we have some more of your comments in the chat room while we are awaiting your calls for my guest, Miss Mary Williams. Lots of comments being made in the chat room. Let me see. Somebody says that the state continues to fail this victim and her family. And the comment being made by St. Lucian activist who is living and working in Barbados, Felicia Dujon. The state continues to fail this victim and her family. But this is not the first time we have been hearing this. Good evening to you, Newsmaker Live. You're on the air.
Good evening to you, Tim.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
I just want to say this. I am a very close family member of Kimberly, right? And I can tell you evidence was given to the police and to the DPP, okay? Can you write? Evidence was given to the police and to the DPP, okay? From the person who was involved. All right. At this point, I no longer look for justice from no police or from no DPP, because at this point, I think we are just fed up. We are fed up. We are not hearing anything. We are fed up. I personally, let me tell you something. The God that I serve and I know Kimberly believed in, God does not sleep, and he is going to expose every single person that was involved in that murder. I can tell you that. Every single hand that was involved in that killing, they are going to be exposed. I live to tell you that. Have a good night.
You too, ma'am. Thank you so much. What say you?
Well, Kimberly always used to tell you, I leave everything for God. God will take care of this. God will take care of that. But you know what? The only thing I want God to do is to give me the courage and strength to fight on, because I have to play my part.
Was she a religious person?
She was.
Okay.
She was. There's not one thing she would tell you if she didn't say God in it. She would always use the word God. But they see the DPP said to me, everything they wanted, they already had it. The only thing they were missing was the ballistic report. So which means there was enough evidence. There was enough evidence, if you're at all what you needed, right, to prosecute somebody. And you were just waiting for that one thing. What made a difference? Why is it nothing has been done? Nothing has been done.
When people say, for example, that the state continues to fail this victim and her family, how do you interpret this? Because that's a statement that could be attributed to so many other families in St. Lucia. I mean, from Giselle Georges to Shaka Dan to a number of other people. Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Hello, good evening.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
How are you doing, sir?
I'm okay, how about you?
I'm okay. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to applaud again Kimberly's mom for taking, I mean, this lady has been taking all the time and resources to fight for justice for her daughter. And I think we need to continue to support this lady at every aspect of society. And the reason why I'm saying that the state continues to fail not only the family of Kimberly, but the society.
Is this Felicia Duja?
It is. I'm okay, sorry. All right. I should have introduced myself.
That's okay. Thanks for calling.
Yes, no problem at all. And I think this matter has been prolonged for such a long time. And the agony that the mother, the family members have to endure on a continuous basis, it's an injustice. It's really an injustice that the state has not recognized that it is time to update not only the family members, but the society. People recognize that an injustice was done. An innocent woman was killed in a home. And the state, regardless of which government is in power, the state has to take the responsibility to provide some kind of update to ensure that some element of justice is brought to this matter. And I think it is time that we recognize that the state has that kind of responsibility, regardless of which government is in power. The DPP, regardless of whether he wants to or comes to the public or not, but something has to, they act on behalf, that the role of the DPP really is to act in the role to act on behalf of the victims, on behalf of the citizens. And so it is very, very alarming that at this point in 2024, we are sitting, looking at a mother in agony, wanting justice and basically pleading for justice from a government, from a society that need to take the responsibility where it's supposed to be. It's disheartening, team. It's really disheartening.
But do you blame solely the authorities or the DPP, the police, or the wider St. Lucian society? Because take for example what is happening in Israel. I'm not saying we should demonstrate in St. Lucia, but see what's happening in Israel, where the family members of those people who have been kidnapped by Hamas, they are challenging their government, they are challenging their prime minister, because they believe that not enough is being done to free those victims.
Well, team, I mean, I'm seeing where you're trying to bring the same kind of, but I think there are two different entities that we're dealing with. Where you're dealing with what is happening in Israel, and it's quite different to what is happening in St. Lucia with this and other matters, as Rick highlighted. There are other similar matters, and I think it's the onus is on the state, it's their responsibility. What do you think taxpayers are paying them for? So that they can wait years and decades to come to the public and say, well, this is what we have gathered thus far. This is how we're going to approach the situation. And also, how many police commissioners have we had over that period of time?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's about time that we as citizens recognize the responsibility and role that the state plays. And the state has that responsibility. And they need to be held accountable. They need to be held accountable. There's no sense of transparency or accountability, and that is the problem that we have in now. This is why continuously families have to come to the public domain and literally plead to persons
within the state, or what would you say, representatives of the state, pleading to them to get their job done, get it done. They need to have some sense of accountability. We cannot continue that way. And I would like to applaud Ms. Mary. Continue to do what you're doing. Do not give up. Do not give up. Because your heart is in the right place. It is your responsibility, and we need to continue to support you until those responsible recognize that it is their duty to bring justice when injustice has been done.
Okay, ma'am.
You take care. Good night.
Thank you so much. You just heard there from Felicia Dujon, previously known as Felicia Brown. She is a St. Lucian academic who lives and works over in Barbados. We have sufficient time. Maybe we can take at least two more calls for my guest. Once again, Miss Mary Williams. She is the mother of Kimberly DeLeon. And Kimberly DeLeon was gunned down in a home on the evening of October 29th of 2018. And since that time, there's not been any outcome as far as that particular case and the police investigation. And Ms. Williams continue to be hopeful that there'll be an outcome. Let me see what is happening in your chat room while we are awaiting your calls. Somebody says, keep the faith and pray for the patience and the wisdom to get through this challenge. And that is some of your contributions in the chat room. Somebody says that the justice system here sucks. Some other comment. Let's see there. What has been disclosed there tonight is very troubling and calls into question the actions of the police and the DPP office. Do you get any kind of hope? Are you confident that based on what you, particularly what you've heard from the callers, that anything positive will happen anytime soon? I mean, when April of 2024, who knows, something positive might happen during the course of this year. You never
just
know.
Just never know. Mm-hmm. Just never know.
Okay. But what is the next course of action for you as we're getting all set to conclude the broadcast?
I can't say that. I can't tell you that.
Okay.
I know what my next course of action is.
But what is, how burdensome is this task that you have right now in terms of seeking justice for your daughter, Kimberly DeLeon?
I'm not looking at it as any burden or any, you know. My mind is fixed.
Mm-hmm.
I am pressing on. I am pursuing justice. And I'm, you know, there's nothing, I'm not allowing anything to come around me. My head is in one direction. And that is to find justice.
Your final comments? The last word?
Well, what I want to say for the families of the victims out there who are going through what I am going through, we need to come together and have a strong voice. We need to come together. We have to demonstrate. We have to let the powers that be know that, you know, we need answers. We need something to be done. Too many killings, too many unnecessary killings, and we have to find a way to do something.
Thank you so much, Mary Williams, mother of Kimberly DeLeon, for being my guest on this evening's Newsmaker Live. We hope that there'll be some kind of positive outcome. You'll be getting some news from the relevant authorities very soon, giving you some kind of progress with regard to what is happening with their investigations into the murder of your daughter, which occurred a little over 5 years ago.
Once again, thanks for having me.
So we hope the next time you appear on the broadcast is so that you can provide us with some good news.
Some good news.
Yeah. And to you, as always, thank you so much for watching the broadcast and contributing via your calls, because if it's Wednesday, it's Newsmaker Live. Time now for the clip that peaked.
Ha 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 ha
Let's broadcast. Thank you so much for watching us. A very good evening. My name is Timothy Pauly. I'm saying good night and see you next time.
Hi, Philip Joseph here.
I would like to be judged as being the Prime Minister, not being judged as being part of a government.
Came into government that we had a manifesto and a vision and mission that had been proven.